with me. I'm going to read a scripture and then let's remain standing for the time of worship. And it's going to be coming out of Psalm 73. I'm going to read verses 26 through 28 and let it speak to you. It says, "My flesh and my heart faileth, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. For lo, they that are far from thee shall perish. Thou hast destroyed all them that go whoring from thee. But it is good for me to draw near to God. I have put my trust in the Lord God, that I may declare all thy works." Let's declare his works and let's glorify him for his works in our life tonight. So many of us got so many things we can be thankful for. I mean, if we had a list, we could put a book together tonight just because of the things that God has done in our lives here in this place. So would you worship him with me? Would you pray to him and let's glorify him tonight? Lord God, we thank you for what you're doing. God, I thank you, God, that we're able to come into your house tonight. God, I thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to be here. God, I thank you that we're able to come together to glorify and lift up your name, Jesus. Pray that you move upon us tonight, your people. God, we come and gather together in your name. God, we need you, Lord, to move upon our service, upon the people. God, there's healings that need to take place. There's sons and daughters that are lost. And God, we trust in you to save them. God, I pray that you would move in this place. People that are seeking for the Holy Ghost, God, I pray that you would fill them, Lord, by your power. You are not weak. God, we trust in you. You are a strong and a powerful God, and we glorify your holy name. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away, it was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away, it was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Must Jesus bear the cross alone, and all the world go free? No, there's a cross for everyone, and there's a cross for me. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away, it was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away, it was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away, it was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my sovereign die? Would he remove that sacred head for such a worm as I? Oh, at the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away, it was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Was it for crimes that I had done, he groaned upon the tree? Amazing. cross, at the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Oh, at the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all day. Oh, at the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all day. Was it for crimes that I had done He groaned upon the tree? Amazing pity, grace unknown, and love beyond degree. Oh, at the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Oh, at the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
It was at that cross that I first saw the light, and He set my soul free. Hallelujah. I am covered by the blood of Jesus Christ tonight. I am covered by that precious blood. Are you covered by that blood?
I am covered, covered, covered by His blood. Walking by faith, living in love. I am covered, covered, covered by His blood. Jesus has rescued me. Well, I am covered, covered, covered by His blood. Walking by faith, living in love. I am covered, covered, covered by His blood. Jesus has rescued me.
I'm reminded of the one who had no sight. Just a little bit of faith and everything was made right. Now if Jesus came and healed that little blind man, I know I can be made whole by the blood of the Lamb.
I am covered, covered, covered by His blood.
I'm walking by faith,
I'm living in love. I am covered, covered, covered by His blood. Jesus has rescued me. I am covered, covered, covered by His blood. Walking by faith, living in love. I am covered, covered, covered by His blood. Jesus has rescued me.
Now Satan has no hold on my life, for I can speak the name of Jesus Christ. Now Satan tries to stop me when he can, but I am delivered by the blood of the Lamb.
I am covered, covered, covered by His blood.
I'm
walking by faith and living in love. I am covered, covered, covered by His blood. Jesus has rescued me. I am covered, covered, covered by His blood. Walking by faith,
I'm
living in love. I am covered, covered, covered by His blood. Jesus has rescued me.
I'm reminded had no sight. Just a little bit of faith and everything was made right. Now Jesus came and healed that little blind man. I know I can be made whole by the blood of the Lamb. I am covered, covered, covered by His blood.
I'm walking by faith, living in love.
I am covered, covered, covered by His blood.
Jesus has rescued me.
Oh, I am covered, covered, covered by His blood.
Walking by faith, living in love.
I am covered, covered, covered by His blood.
Jesus has rescued me.
Now Satan has no hold on my life, for I can speak the name of Jesus Christ. Now Satan tries to stop me when he can, but I am delivered by the blood of the Lamb.
I am covered, covered, covered by His blood.
I'm walking by faith,
and I'm living in love.
I am covered, covered, covered by His blood.
Jesus has rescued me.
Now Satan has no hold on my life, for I can speak the name of Jesus Christ. Now Satan tries to stop me when he can, but I am delivered by the blood of the Lamb.
I am covered, covered, covered by His blood.
I am walking by faith,
and I'm living in love.
I am covered, covered, covered by His blood.
Jesus has rescued me.
Oh, I am covered, covered, covered by His blood.
I'm walking by faith,
I'm living in love.
I am covered, covered, covered by His blood.
Jesus has rescued me.
Satan doesn't have a hold on our life as long as the blood is applied to our life. Hallelujah. That's a reason to give Him praise and give Him thanks. That blood, hallelujah, is a barrier between you and the enemy. That blood has power, eternal, everlasting power. This blood, hallelujah, is the most wonderful thing there is.
There is a blood that cost a life, paid my way. Death its price, when it flowed down from the cross, my sins were gone, my sins forgot. There is a grave that tried to hide that precious blood that gave me life.
In 3 days He breathed again, rose to stand in my defense. So I come to tell you He's alive, to tell you that He tries every tear that falls. So I come to tell you that He saves, to shout and to proclaim that He's coming back for you. This life, this price, this blood, this one.
Heal the sick, the
lonely fire. Oh, it has its power to free the bound, has chained their foes upon the ground. So pour it out, cleanse my soul, and let its liquid glory flow.
Because it lives to make me whole, I owe my life, I owe my all. So I come to tell you he's alive, to tell you that he dries every tear that falls. So I come to tell you that he saves, to shout and to proclaim that he's coming back for you. This life, this prize, this blood, this one, his blood that cost a life, paid my way. Death is prized when it flowed down from the cross. My sins were gone, my sins forgot. There is a grave that tried to hide his precious blood that gave me life.
In 3 days he breathed again, rose to stand in my defense. So I've come to tell you he's alive, to tell you that he dries every tear that falls. So I come to tell you that he saves, to shout and to proclaim that he's coming back for you. This life, this prize, this blood, this wash away my sin. Nothing, oh, nothing. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood, nothing but the blood.
So I've
come to tell you he's alive, to tell you that he dries every tear that falls. So I come to tell you that he saves, to shout and to proclaim that he's coming back for you. This life, this prize, this blood, this one,
there is a blood that cost a life, paid my way. Death its price when it flowed down from the cross. My sins were gone, my sins forgot. There is a grave that tried to hide that precious blood that gave me life.
In 3 days he breathed again, rose to stand in my defense. So I come to tell you.
you that he dries every tear that falls. So I come to tell you that he saves, to shout it, to proclaim that he's coming back for you. This life, this price, this blood, this one.
I don't know enough of it to sing it again. I'm learning it. But I like it, amen. Can you do it again? Can you take us up to that part where we get into that old hymnal that says, what can wash away my sin? Aren't you thankful for the blood tonight?
Every tear that falls. So I come to tell you that he saves, to shout it, to proclaim that he's coming back for you. This life, this prize, this blood, this one. Wash away my sin. Nothing, nothing. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood. Nothing but the blood. So I come to tell you he's alive, to tell you that he dries every tear that falls. So I come to tell you that he saves, to shout it, to proclaim that he's coming back for you. This life, this prize, this blood, this one.
Oh, there's the blood. Oh, it sights the blind. Heal the sick. Lowly find. Oh, it has its power to free the bound. Has changed the fall upon the ground. So pour it out. Cleanse my soul. Let its liquid glory flow.
Because it lives to make me whole. I owe my life, I owe my all. So I come to tell you he's alive, to tell you that he dries every tear that falls. So I come to tell you that he saves, to shout it, to proclaim that he's coming back for you. This life, this prize, this blood, this one. What can wash away my sin? Nothing, nothing. What can make me whole again? proclaim that he's coming back for you. This life, this prize, this blood, this one.
Oh, give the Lord a hand clap of praise for that. Grab somebody by the hand. Seriously, bring them to the choir with you. Let's fill up this choir and sing tonight.
Sing, but they did something wrong. They said nothing twice, but there's nothing but the blood of Jesus. I told my wife, I said, that thing needs to say Jesus in there. My, you can bite the head off a chicken and get blood, and that's what the voodooists do, but I'm no chicken, and I'm not a chicken biter, head biter offer either. But I love the Lord tonight. And I want to sing about this amazing grace that he has for me. Amen.
Thank you. and shining crown. And when the battle's over, we shall wear our crown in the new Jerusalem. Oh, when the battle's over, we shall wear our crown. We shall wear our crown. We shall wear our crown. And when the battle's over, we shall wear our crown in the new Jerusalem. Wear our crown. Wear our crown. Wear our crown. And shining crown. And when the battle's over, we shall wear our crown in the new Jerusalem. We'll see you wear our crown one more time. Wear our crown. Wear our crown. Wear our crown. And shining crown. And when the battle's over, we shall wear our crown in the new Jerusalem.
Give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Are you looking forward to going to heaven tonight? Amen. Hallelujah. What a joy it is to be with you on a Sunday night. If you are watching via the internet, we're delighted to have you with us tonight. For all the home folks, glad you're here. For all the guests tonight, first-time guests and visitors, we're glad you're here. I'm glad Jesus is here tonight. Amen. Already have felt his presence in this place tonight. Looking forward to what God has for us. Visitors, if you'll take that connection card in front of you, fill it out. Drop it in the offering plate. Stop it by the Welcome Center and turn that in tonight. I know they would appreciate that. And if you are visiting with us tonight, go by and grab your mug. I still haven't bought my wife one of these yet. I need to do that. She drinks coffee. But if you're visiting, you get yours for free. But if you're not visiting, you can buy yours for $5. Amen. And they have that in the Welcome Center out back. And so let's just do what we can. I just love what God is doing in my heart and in my life. And I have some more prayer requests tonight. Remember Brother Gene Simpson. God knows the need in his life. Brother Jerry goes in, I think it's Tuesday, right? They postponed it, all right? Well, they're going to be doing some major surgery. So he's got some other things going on. And so let's remember Jerry in prayer. Others that are still fighting this sickness, let's remember them in prayer. Let's remember our church in prayer, that all that we do unto the name of the Lord. And I know that he will be faithful to us if we are faithful to him. Can you say amen for that tonight? Amen. All right, ushers, come on and get ready to wait upon us tonight. Let's give us giving to the Lord while they're coming. Don't forget about Fall Festival and youth takeover service and communities, all those things that are planned. The good thing about it is all of that stuff happens right here. So we don't have to travel anywhere, don't have to go anywhere. We just got to be in church and be at our appointed times. If you have any questions on any of those events, if you'll call the office and make sure to get in touch with them, they'll do their very best to help you answer all your questions. And if they don't know, they're liable to even make it up as you go. Amen. I'm learning. I leave throughout the day sometimes. I get this indication. They want me just to leave and leave them alone for a few hours. I think they get more done when I'm not here, because as long as I'm here, I'm going to stir something up. Amen. We're going to be doing something. And so I'll leave and I'll come back and I'll say, did you miss me? Miss Christy, don't answer too quickly. She's still new. Miss Rebecca's been with me for a long time, and she'll say something like, oh, were you gone? I know what that means. Leave them alone. Let them work. I will tell you, you are blessed with a wonderful staff here, and that's the way it should be. There should be folks in place that can keep it moving. Pastors should not have to do everything all the time, but I do like to come in and stir the pot every now and then, and I'm thankful for the team. I'm thankful for you. I'm thankful there's a good Sunday night crowd again tonight. Amen. We can lift up the name of Jesus. I was praying earlier, Lord, just let the Holy Ghost just hover over this place tonight and shake us and stir us and speak to us. And I believe He'll do that if we'll just be ready. Let's pray tonight. By now, you should have had time to write that check. Put a couple extra zeros on it to the left of the decimal, and let's give to the Lord tonight. Father, You are so good to us. You've been faithful. Lord, You've been merciful. You've been, Lord, just full of grace and love. And for that, we are thankful. We pray tonight as we give of our tithes and of our offerings, Lord, it all belongs to You. We're just stewards of it. Take what we give, Lord. Lord, bless it for its intended use. Bless the remaining part that our home obligations will be met. Lord, and we'll be sure and first to give You all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory for it. In the name of Christ we pray. And everybody said amen and amen. God bless you as you give tonight.
And we're going to fly away one of these days. Amen. It's good to see each and every one of you here tonight. Don't forget, pecans are coming in. Pecans. I've already got orders for some of them. Let me know I want this many or that many. So keep bringing them in. Maybe we can have them all sold when they get here. That would be awesome. Amen. It's good to see Sister Lily here this morning and tonight. She'd been sick for a couple weeks, and good to see her back with us. I told her this morning that we missed her. She had some problems with her sugar and finally got it straightened out. So it's good to see you, Sister Lily. Amen. We're in for a special treat tonight for our singing. Our youth crowd's coming, but before that, we have a mystery singer, a special guest. Your very own pastor is going to come sing for us, Pastor Thomas.
Oh my, you're all disappointed now, aren't you? Amen. No, they had an opening on the schedule. I said, write my name right there. Amen. I think we found the key. My voice has changed. I'm still growing up, and so we had to find a brand new key. No, it's just the croup that they're preaching this morning. We hope we can do it in this one. I don't sing too much like this. I don't sing too many songs, but I like this one. Sing it with us. I can take a heart that's broken and make it over again, but I know a man who can. I can take a soul that's sin sick and make it white as the snow, but I know a man who can. Some call
saw him, Savior, the Redeemer of all men. But I call him Jesus, for he's my dearest friend. So if you feel that no one loves you and your life is out of hand, well, I know a man who can. Oh, some call him Savior, the Redeemer of all men. But I call him Jesus, for he's my dearest friend. So if you feel that no one loves you and your life is out of hand, well, I know a man who can. I can't walk upon the waters or calm the troubled sea, but I know a man who can. I can't cause blinded eyes to open or make the lame to walk again, but I know a man who can. Oh, some call him Savior, the Redeemer of all men. Oh, but I call him Jesus, for he's my dearest friend. So if you feel that no one loves you and your life is out of hand, well, I know a man who can. Oh, some call him Savior, the Redeemer of all men. Oh, but I call him Jesus, for he's my dearest friend. So if you feel that no one loves you and your life is out of hand, well, I know a man who can.
Give the Lord a hand clap of praise for that. All right, youth choir, come on and sing for us.
lost my focus and went astray. Possessions that were so dear, and I lost some battles by walking in fear. But in the midst of my struggles and my season of pain, the one thing never wavered, one thing never changed. Oh no,
I never lost my joy, I never lost my game, but most of all,
so dear. I've lost some battles by walking in fear, but in the midst of my struggles and my season of pain, one thing never wavered, one thing never changed.
I never lost my hope.
Aren't you glad in the middle of difficulty and trial, we don't have to lose our praise? Amen. Difficulty trials come, but I can have praise and joy and faith and hope through it all because Jesus is my helper. Amen. Stand with me for the reading of God's Word tonight. Again, if you're visiting with us, delighted to have you with us. 2 Peter chapter number 3. 2 Peter chapter number 3. While you're finding that, let me remind you about homecoming. Just a few weeks away, a Saturday night and a Sunday morning. Grab one of those invite cards from your pew and take them home and let somebody know. Invite them to be with us. We'll stock those pews back up with invite cards for next Sunday where you can have some more. And there may be extra in the Information Welcome Center area if you want to grab some and use them. And let's invite folks to be with us for our 61st homecoming the first weekend of November. 2 Peter chapter number 3, verse number 1. The second epistle, beloved, I now write unto you, in both which I stir up your pure minds by way of remembrance, that ye may be mindful of the words which were spoken before by the holy prophets, and of the commandments of us the apostles, the Lord and Savior, knowing this first, that there shall come in the last days scoffers walking after their own lust, and saying, where is the promise of His coming? For a little while tonight, I'm not going to finish. There's no way. They've got 18 pages of slides back there, not counting notes. I'm not going to finish. So if you'll get here with me and preach with me for a while and say amen every now and then, when I get to a stopping point, I'll land this thing. We'll pray and we'll go home. If you don't help me, I'm going to preach till midnight because there's probably enough right here in front of me. But if you'll help me, I'm going to preach to us on this thought. Don't go back when He is coming. Don't go back. Jesus is about to come. And I want to be ready. Would you stretch your hands toward heaven? Ask God to help us. Father, we love you tonight. Thank you for the worship. Thank you for the songs of Zion. Thank you, Lord, for the time we've already had being in your house and in your presence. Lord, I'm aware of the hour. I'm aware of the time. I know where we stand. I just pray for the next few moments, Lord, that you'll anoint me. Let me deliver what is before us, Lord. Give me that unction that allows it to be effective. Lord, let us receive and hear and do what you've called us to do. Let us, Lord, don't give up in the race which we're running. Lord, we're too close to going home to back up now. But let us, God, be stirred and be reminded and be charged, knowing that you're with us, and we'll forever give you praise, honor, and glory. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen and amen. You may be seated tonight. Don't go back. Can I encourage you tonight? Don't go back. Don't quit on the Lord. Why? Because He is coming. In chapter number 2, the chapter before the text that I read tonight, Peter said, but there were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you. Now, if you know Peter, Peter is an individual that pulls absolutely no punches. Peter tells it like it is, and here he is saying that there will be false teachers among you. There will be those that are coming to spread a false doctrine and a false religion. And you may say, well, why was it that Peter was so straightforward? It was because Peter fully understood the destructive nature of false doctrine and false teachers. And I would have to say with Peter that it is serious business. And we need to know what we believe. We need to know why we believe it. It's not just a social gathering that we come to. It's not just a feel-good setting, but there is a word that is to be rightly divided, and there are principles upon which we live, and if we're not careful, we will follow false doctrine. He knew that if Peter knew if the people followed those false teachers and their doctrine, they would be lost forever. And I would offer to you tonight, it's such a serious issue in our day and in our time that we need to train up our children in a way that they know what the Word of God says. Now, in order to do that, a couple of things have to happen. Number one, you have to know as a parent what it says. Hard to teach somebody something if you don't know how to do it yourself. Amen. Number two, you have to be an example for them and live it out in front of them. It's not just preacher's responsibility or youth pastor's responsibility or children's pastor's responsibility to give the example. No, we're not with them near as much as you're with them. And it's parents' jobs to instruct and to teach. And then let me also add to this, we need to live it fully. Not just at home. Let me throw it the other way. Not just when you're with the church folks. Not when you're just with your kids, but it needs to be embedded in us so much that everywhere we go, we're living a life of Christ. Peter goes on to tell us who probably shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that bought them and bring upon themselves swift destruction. He says those false teachings, those false doctrine are coming, and when they come, they're going to bring in damnable heresies. Now that word heresies is a very interesting word. It comes from a root word that means a chosen course of thought or action. So when we apply that definition to the life of a Christian, we could say it means a course of thought or action that varies from the truth. Can I tell you? There are those today, as they were in the days of Peter, that are teaching things that are contrary to the Word of God. They're hiding them under the disguise of religion. They're hiding them under the disguise of church. They're hiding them under the disguise of not-for-profits and things of that nature. But honey, it is more important today than ever before we know what thus saith the word of the Lord, because it is by this that we will be judged. And I don't want to be caught up in a heresy, a thought or an action that varies from the truth. Now the way this happens is we begin to take a little step off of the main course. And the longer I walk off of the main step, the farther and farther I get away from God. And I said, Lord, my job on a Sunday night in October is to stir up in us again, remind us, help us remember that there is a right way. There is a way that is full of truth. Peter said there were false teachers and that they would come and they would turn away from the truth. And then he gives us some characteristics of what those false teachers will look like. That's where I'm going to spend a little bit of time tonight. Because I believe in the age in which we live, it's important we know what's around us. You know the old saying, if it looks like a duck and quacks like a duck and walks like a duck, it's probably a duck. Not real spiritual, but it sure does help me preach tonight. And so if I know what the characteristics of a false teacher will be, then as I'm going about and I'm intermingling with the things of my life and society and the people that I work with and my family, then I can keep my radar up and say, Lord, don't let me be taken by surprise and don't let me sell short. And please, God, don't let me fall for something that's not true. Number one tonight in this area, false teachers, they will walk after the flesh and live unclean lives because of it. Paul warned us in the book of Romans chapter 8, for if you live after the flesh, you shall die. But if you live through the Spirit, do mortify the deeds of the body, you shall live. The death he is speaking here is not a physical death, but a spiritual death. If you cater to your flesh, you will die spiritually. Well, Pastor, it's all about me. It's about what I want to do and when I want to do it and how I want to do it. And if you don't like it, I'm going to do it. Let me just warn you that if you walk after the flesh, you will die spiritually. It is sometimes good for us to deny self. It is sometimes good for us to put self in a time of fasting and prayer and without. That way we don't get caught up and said, do you know that our Adam nature is programmed us in such a way that we want to satisfy the desires of the flesh? at a young age. Today, I think even younger than what it was when I was a teenager. Our kids are being inundated with things from society that tells them, oh, do what feels good, and it doesn't matter what others think, and it's all about you. No, we need to be careful. The death is not a physical death, but a spiritually death. And if you cater to the flesh, and you do what the flesh wants to do all the time, you will die spiritually, for we realize the flesh is fighting against the spirit, and the spirit fights against the flesh. And if you let the flesh win, you will be lost forever. It does matter how you live. I'm going to say it again. Get ready for an amen. It does matter how you live. What happened to being called out and separated and sanctified and set apart and having a mark on us, not as the world gives us, but a mark that is given to us by Christ. What happened to personal convictions? And what happened to saying, oh no, there's a line in the sand and that's not coming into my house and into my life and into my children? Why? Because if we're not careful, we will satisfy the flesh. Some folks don't like what Peter said. Some folks don't like, even in this setting, no doubt, what I've said. But can I tell you, it is important that we do not walk after the flesh. Number two, false prophets, false teachers, they despise government. Now the government, the word government, is used here in a way that is defined as authority. The word despise is a very strong word. It means to disdain or to think little or nothing of. Those false teachers, they do not want anyone to rule over them or tell them what they can and cannot do. I am a daddy. I will be a daddy now as long as I live. And there are some things that my kids will do simply because I tell them, you will do this. Now they may look at me and say, I don't understand. And I will tell them, sometimes it's not for you to understand until later. But trust me, as a parent, child, I'm not doing this for my good. I'm doing this for your good. And we have raised our children. Hopefully you've raised your children in a way that you can have a rule over them. Not as a lord, if you will, but as a way to guide them and direct them in a way that they don't get ate up by the world. I don't want my kids to fall into harm. I don't want my kids to find themselves in danger, in jail, or in situations of life that would not be becoming to a Christian. Nor do you want your kids to do that. Can I tell you, there is a place in each of our lives for authority. There's a place in each of our life for government. And I can tell you of a truth tonight, that's some of the problem that we have in some of the churches, is people don't want anyone, including the Word of God, to tell them what they're going to do. Right. Problem with that. They've taken a very risky position. Because they're going to live like they want to live, no matter what God says or the preacher says or the Holy Ghost says. And when we begin to do that, my friend, we're walking on very dangerous grounds. Thirdly, characteristics of a false teacher. They are presumptuous. It means that they are very bold. Very bold in what? Very bold in speaking out against those in leadership or authority. They not only speak out against people in authority, but they even speak evil of dignities. And if you study that out in the scripture, that the word dignities there is the glorious ones, and it refers to the angels. And Peter is telling us that those false teachers will even begin to speak evil of the angels. I tell you, we need to be real careful what we say about those over us in the Lord. The good part about this message tonight, To my knowledge, I can preach it with a clear conscience, because to my knowledge, if anybody has not agreed with leadership and authority in the last week or so, you haven't told me, and for that I'm thankful. So I can preach tonight out of a concern as a shepherd and say, God, don't let us fall into a trap where we begin looking down our so-called spiritual nose at everybody and anybody and think we're better than they are. Because when we think we're better than they are, that's probably an indication that we need to go back to the altar of prayer. They're bold and they speak evil against those that are in authority and in leadership. I am the priest of my home. Husbands, you are the priest of your home. What you say should mean something to those that are in your home. Now, if you do a poor job in communicating, or if you do a poor job in following through, or nobody takes you serious, then you need to work on that. But as men of God, it is our job to lead our home. And this is the roadmap in which we've been given. And if I want to keep false teachers and false prophets from affecting my children in a way that is negative, I need to know how to show authority and respect to those that are over me in the Lord. Why? Because they won't do it in your house if you don't do it first. Four, false teachers, false prophets are self-willed. They live only to please themselves. If you read self-help books, don't fall out with me. But how many self-help books have we seen in the last 2 decades? In the last decade, in the last 5 years, there's numerous ones of them. We've seen a flood of them. Many of them tell us what to do, that is best for us, and don't worry about others. But I will tell you, that is the opposite of a true spirit of Christianity. Christianity is about Christ, and Christ is about others. He came to help others, and if we are His, we're going to want to help others as well. It's not about you. It's not. It's not about me. It's not about that first lady of this church. It's not about the Modem kids. And if you ever think it is, you just ask them, because I remind them often, we are here to serve. I'm not here to be taken advantage of. I'm not here to be run over. I'm here to be a disciple of Christ and a shepherd to a congregation. You're not here to be taken advantage of. Just because we're Christians does not mean we're doormats for people, but it does mean it is not about us. It is about Christ. And I have to ask myself, what would Jesus do? Sometimes He would go back and extend the olive branch, even really when it wasn't His place to extend it. He would go back and wrap His arm around somebody, even though they wronged Him and said something bad about Him and falsely accused Him. I said, Lord, if Jesus, the Savior of my soul, can die on a Calvary's cross for me, knowing the wretched guy that I was, if He can hang on that cross knowing what all those of that day did to Him and said about Him, and He can say, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do, can I tell you that I have no reason to get huffy and puffy about anybody or anything in my life, because last time I checked, nobody's tried to crucify me yet. But those false teachers, false prophets are self, it's all about them. It's all about them. Don't even get me started on sending in your offering to them and things like that. Number five, let me move on. I'll start meddling. Number five, false teachers, false prophets, they are brute beasts. It means that they do not reason properly. And so they speak evil of the things that they don't understand. Can I tell you, one of the challenges that we have as a Pentecostal church is everybody does not understand us Pentecostal folks. And our job is to let them see that we're not bad folks. Amen. Yes, we are. Let me be careful here. We are very expressive. When people ask me, where do you attend church? And I tell them, and they say, well, what does that mean? I will say words like, well, we are Pentecostal. If that doesn't ring a bell, I will say we are very lively in our worship. I'll say we are a hands-up church. And by the time I get to that, they have already painted a picture in their mind as to what we are. I'm not ashamed of it. It's brought me a long way. Thank you, Jesus. I don't believe we're the only flavor going to heaven. I think I've got some good Baptist folks that will meet me there, maybe even beat me there, but they'll be there. Amen? I know that. But we have to be careful today, because today we have people who criticize the Pentecostal movement. They are very bold in denouncing anyone who claims to be Pentecostal. And most of the time it's because they simply just do not understand what Pentecost is all about. See, some of you grew up in this thing. This is all you know. But for some others of you, you didn't get into this Pentecostal way until later in life. And some of you are still trying to figure it out. Can I tell you a couple things about Pentecost? The Holy Ghost is a perfect gentleman, and He will never make you do something that you're not willing to do. You have to yield. Secondly, He always does things in decency and in order. Always. If it's not decent and in order, honey, it ain't the Holy Ghost. I can tell you that. And thirdly, He will be a comfort to you like none other. Now that's wrapping it all up in a little old pea can, if you will, and giving it to you. But I can tell you, it's nothing to be afraid of. I'm reminded, we were at that wedding last weekend, and the church in which they got married at, the Poolers and the Rodens, Jelena and Kayla, where they were married, that is the church that my grandfather attended for the last 21 or so years of his life. Prior to that, most of his life, he had been a Southern Baptist minister, went to school out in the Panhandle and was credentialed by them and held Southern Baptist appointments as pastors. My dad and his brothers and sister grew up, for the most part, in a parsonage, in a home, pastor's home. And there came a time in his life that they didn't have an assignment, so they thought they would go and spend time with the grandkids. Now, the problem with that is us grandkids attended the Pentecostal church. When my dad and my mom got married, my dad walked away from the Baptist movement and said, if I'm marrying this individual, she's going to be only Pentecostal. And if he wanted to be with her, he had to go Pentecost all the way. There was none of this, let's go here on Sunday morning and there on Sunday night. I don't know the conversation. I wasn't there. But I know my mama enough to say, oh no, it's either all or it's none. And that's the way it should be. That's just my opinion. So they got married, and they were blessed with me first. I mean, it's just amazing what God will do. There was four of us. My grandparents came to the Church of God there in Stark. That's home for me. And we sit right over in that corner, about where I think it was about the third pew, where Roger and Jane are at. And that's just, my mama didn't let us on the back pew. We just didn't do that. And I had a mama like y'all did. You know, she snapped or pinched or pointed or looked at you. She had a way of communicating, and honey, you knew if you were in trouble before you even got out of church. Got home, you knew it. But they begin to hang around that. They begin to realize that us Pentecostal folks are not demon-possessed, and we're not bad folks, and that it's not total chaos, because God always does things in decency and in order. Just a few months with us, they got another appointment to a Baptist church. Now, it's hard to be a Baptist preacher when you have felt the fire of Pentecost. But he tried. And it didn't work. And a few months later, I don't remember the number of months or time, they resigned and said, you know, this is just not for us. I knew what it was. Looking back on it now, it was that desire to have true Pentecost. They found themselves attending a Church of God closer to their home, closer to where they lived. And for 20 plus years, that's where they attended. I was just there a few days ago for the wedding. And Johnny, one of the pastor's son-in-laws, came to me. We were just chatting about just life. And I wasn't even thinking about Grandpa. He says, I sure do miss Grandpa Odom. I said, yes, sir. I said, he's been gone for a while now, but we'll get to see him again. He said, he just made such an impact on our church. Now, that may not do anything for you, but it does a lot for me, because I still believe this Pentecostal way is right. I'm not ashamed of being baptized in the Holy Ghost. I'm not ashamed of speaking in other tongues as the Spirit gives the utterance. I'm not ashamed. I have been around. I have seen it happen. It's been a long time since I've seen someone run the back of the pews, but I've seen it happen, and oh, that God would do it again in our church. Why? Because I want to stay away from false doctrine. And I want to stay away from a feel-good religion. And I want to stay away from those things that teach us that you don't have to be different. Can I tell you, when Christ gave His everything for us, we should have no problem saying, "Not my will, God, but Thy will be done." Got to hurry. Number six, is that where I'm at? False teachers, false prophets have adulterous eyes. Can I tell you, we live in a sex-crave world. And if you think your kids are shunned and don't see it because you don't talk about it, can I tell you, you're fooling no one but yourself. I've preached about them. I'm not preaching against them. I preach about them. If they carry an electronic device in their hand, you need to know what's on it. Because they can see more on that device than you ever was able to see as a kid. Trust me. And we live in a time when our false teachers and false prophets are adulterous in their ways, and there's no standards and there's no morals. We hear stories of people falling, this one running off with that one, this one having an affair with that one, this one. It's not of the Lord. Now, I will insert here that I am thankful for His amazing grace. And I am thankful that I know of people that have dealt with things that have not been of God, and they have come to their senses, if you will, and they have realized the error of their way, and God has been graceful and merciful and long-suffering, and I'm thankful for that. But just because God is full of grace and full of mercy, we do not need to take it for granted. And we need to say, God, put a hedge around us, put a hedge around our children, put a hedge around our homes, honey, put a hedge around their cars and their trucks, and put a hedge around their mind, because you don't know what they're facing when they're not right beside you. And kids, let me just preach to you for a moment. You might think your mom and daddy's the dumbest mom and daddy in the world, because truth be known, you have thought that about them at some point. And if you haven't yet, you probably will. And I pray when you do, God convicts you and reminds you of that statement that I just made. And you might be able to do more on your tablet and device and iPhone and computer than they ever will. But if you got a mom and daddy that hangs around Pentecost long enough, and they're certainly true about their desire to live right for Christ and for the cause of Christ, can I tell you that they don't have to know how to use your device? They can lay in a prayer room somewhere and God will give it to them. So don't think just because you got the password on the phone and mom and daddy don't need a password. The Holy Ghost don't need a password. The Holy Ghost knows the very intentions of your heart. And He can use a mama or a daddy, a grandmama or a grandpa. He'll even use a first lady and a pastor's wife to say, "Hey, why don't you go check that device out? Let's see what's on there." Say, "Pastor, why are you saying?" "Because I've dealt with it. In 8 years of being here, I've had parents and students have to bring devices to me and leave them in my office because of things on them that was not of God. And they said, no longer in my house." I said, "They can sit right here in my office until you want to come pick it back up." This adulterous world that we live in is no more than an attack of the enemy to get us off of the way that is right and out of the way that is full of truth. And if we're not careful, we'll be wrapped up in it so much that we won't even realize that we have not followed God. Some of you are squirming right now because you're wondering, how far is He going to take this? I'm going to tell you how far I'm going to take it. You need to know what's right, and you need to stay out of what's not right. And there are some things that you should not be involved in until you stand before God and a preacher somewhere and you say, I do. And if you're confused on that, you better go find a mama and daddy. And if they're confused on that, you come find pastor. And to the best of my ability, me and that lady in purple will tell you all we know about what thus saith the word of God, because your soul is not worth missing heaven over. Gotta go. Number 7. Covetousness, people. I'm going to preach 7, 8, 9, and we're going to pray. I won't finish. This means that they're fond of money. They desire more of it. Peter gives us an Old Testament example of covetousness when he talks about Balaam. If you know the story of Balaam, the king tried to hire Balaam to curse Israel for a wheelbarrow full of money. Can I just drop a hint here and drop a nugget here and drop a thought here that you need to be careful you do not get caught in the money trap. I love money, but only after I love Jesus. What do you mean by that, Pastor? The love of money is the root of, what's it say? All evil. So if I love going to Chick-fil-A and ordering me a number, whatever, a 4-count chicken minis with a number 4. They gave me one of those Chick-fil-A cards, those A-list cards, because she says, you're in here an awful lot. Can I give you? I said, yeah. And I found out the more I spend, the more free stuff they give me. Now, what's wrong with that picture? Okay, I don't get a lot of free stuff. I don't spend a whole lot of money. So I love having a little bit of money to go up there and buy me a 4-count of chicken. Now, when I'm real hungry, it's a 4-count of chicken minis, a bacon, egg, and cheese biscuit, no hash browns, and a medium sweet tea. Okay? That's a lot of food, but I'm a growing boy. That's what we had. That's what I had the other day. Man, I was starving the other day when we went. Starving? He finished before I was hungry. I must have wrestled all night in my sleep or something. I don't know. So I like the ideal. I love the ideal of having a little bit of money to spend, you know, to buy. Sister Wendy went shopping yesterday, and we took about an hour and a half, and I got to hurry. We took about an hour and a half, and we did a little bit of team building. You can build a team real good with women if you just take them shopping. Amen. I said, guys, we're stopping at the outlet mall for 90 minutes. At 10 to 11:30. At 11:30, we're leaving. And the husband said, can we make it just an hour? Had a great time. She bought her some smelly good stuff, Yankee Candle stuff, I don't know. I walked in the store and was there about 5 minutes, and my head was, I can't handle all them smells, I left. But she come out with a bag and said, will you carry this? Yeah. Okay. It's not wrong to have money. It's wrong to love money more than you love anything else. You say, well, I don't like having a dollar or two in my pocket. You're lying. Because all of us like to go out and buy us an ice cream every now and then. Nothing wrong with that. But I got to make sure I don't live for money. I got to make sure that my number one desire is not money. It's not about a job or a career first. It's about what God wants me to do. And after I find the will of God, He will provide for you the job and the career and the income that you need to do what God has called you to do. Number 8. Wells without water. I got to read this one. Come on, baby. Or you or Holly, whoever's playing. Wells without water. The word well here is interesting in the Greek. It really is the word used for a flowing spring. So Peter is saying that they are springs that have no water. In other words, they're all dried up. Honey, I know some churches that are all, they're twice dead and plucked up by the root. And they have the name Pentecostal, if you will, over. It's sad. Well, what's happened is we have taken on this approach of trying to have wells, but the wells are dried up. There's nothing flowing. Why? Because they haven't prayed a little bit about it. Number 9, they're clouds without water. They're like clouds that build. You know how it is. You watch the storm cloud build. The clouds build in the sky. The cloud gives you a hope that it's going to rain, but it never rains. Apostle Peter's using some very harsh words here, but they were necessary in his day because there were many false teachers around, and it is the same, if not even worse, in our day because we're living in the time of the end, and Jesus said the devil's big gun for the last day would be deception. Just in my little old 40 years of living, I know people that have turned their backs on God. They've been deceived for something else. Don't let it be you. Let me hurry. Play. Matthew 24 and 4. Take heed that no man deceive you. For many shall come in my name, shall deceive many. So let's be careful tonight that we know what the characteristics of a false teacher, false prophet are. And let's make sure tonight that we're not deceived. Everything that is on Christian television, I do not agree with. Everything that's in the self-help section of bookstores, I do not agree with. Everything that people want to hand me out, I just get sick and tired of going to places. They want to hand me a magazine. A pamphlet, I think they call it. It's the Watchtower, folks. I don't believe in that nonsense. A few years ago, I just got fed up to hear with it. They would catch me usually at Sam's early in the morning. I see them coming across the parking lot. Here they come. I don't want to be mean because I want to have the life of Christ and love like Jesus. But I ain't got time for that nonsense. I don't believe in that. It's a false doctrine. But I don't want to be rude. So I said, Lord, you got to help me. I mean, they would catch me like every week. So, they are nice about it. Can I give you something to read? Well, I began to ask them, what is it? Well, that didn't work because they know how to answer that question. So then I had to change it. Who puts it out? That's a very direct question. They're not going to lie to me for the most part. Who puts it out when they say the Watchtower group? I know what it is. And I'll say, no, ma'am, I'm not interested at all. I don't do that to be rude. I don't think Christ would want me to be rude. But I'm going to tell you, I don't want the stuff even riding in the vehicle with me. Right. Pastor, that's crazy. You call it what you want. I got 3 kids that I'm trying to raise to love Jesus. And I don't want them by chance to pick something up that plants a seed in their life that's not right. And I don't even know about it. And something else comes along and waters it in the wrong way. No, I've prayed too hard for these kids. I've given them back to God. They are His. And I'm going to do all I can to ensure those 9 characteristics of a false teacher, false prophet never find their way to my house. Now let's just be truthful. Some of those characteristics we have to even deal with in our own life. Now, I'm not calling you a false teacher. I'm not calling you a false prophet. But we live in a world where this is so heavy on us that if we don't keep a mind of Christ, some of those things that I've described tonight will begin to affect us as parents and grandparents and students. And that's why it's more important than ever before that we spend some time in prayer with the Lord. Clean me, O God. And I've preached way too long. I'm sorry for the time perspective, but I'm not sorry for the Word of God. And before you leave tonight, would you come and would you gather around this altar, kids on that platform, and would you ask God to cleanse you of anything that is not pleasing to Him? And if you'll open your spiritual ear, He'll talk to you. He'll tell you what's happening in your life. He knows you better than you know yourself. He knows you probably better than mama and daddy does. Because let's face it, young people, you try to hide things from them. I was a teenager, I know. I hated it when mama found out. I hated it when she'd been alone with the Lord and the Lord told her some things. And she knew just right what question. She might not have known all the details, but she knew enough to ask the right questions, Pastor, that He didn't put me in a predicament. I had to lie or tell the truth. And we were told not to lie because liars go to hell. So I had to tell the truth. And usually before I was done, I was in all kind of trouble. because of the Spirit of God. What we need is the Spirit of God to purge us. Come on, come pray. I can't stop. I want to preach. I want to keep going. I'm only about halfway done. You got to go home at some point tonight. You've been good to me today. Let's come and gather around this altar. Let's just ask God to purge us. Let's just ask God to deal with us. Let's just ask God to check the intentions of our heart. Let's ask God if there be anything that's not pleasing to Him, to bring it to our attention, that we can ask God to remove it from us. Father, we love You tonight. Father, Lord, I don't want to take up these people's time. God, I don't want to abuse their privilege to be in church tonight. God, I don't want to take advantage of that. But God, I'm so concerned tonight. God, I believe this afternoon You dropped the thought of being faithful in my spirit. God, and if I'm going to be faithful, God, I've got to preach and I've got to teach about it all.
Drink from the cup in Your hand. Lay back
against
You and breathe. Feel Your heartbeat. This love is so deep. It's more than I can stand. I melt in Your peace. It's overwhelming. The more I seek You, the more I find You. The more I find You, the more I love You. Yeah. I want to sit at Your feet, drink from the cup in Your hand, lay back against You and breathe, feel Your heartbeat. This love is so deep. It's more than I can stand. I melt in Your peace. It's overwhelming. I want to sit at Your feet. Drink from the cup in Your hand. Lay back against You and breathe. Feel Your heartbeat. This love is so deep. More than I can stand. I melt in Your peace. It's overwhelming. The more I seek You, the more I love You. The more I find You, the more I love You. Oh, I want to sit at Your feet, drink from the cup in Your hand, lay back against You and breathe, feel Your heartbeat. This love is so deep, it's more than I can stand. I melt in Your peace. It's overwhelming. Draw me. Draw me, Lord. I come running after You. All I want to do is worship. All I want is you is lay here right at your feet. As I lift my hands toward heaven, let your fire fall down on me. Rekindle the fire within me, Lord. Once again, all I want to do is love you. All I want to do is worship. All I want is you is lay here right at your feet. As I lift my hands toward heaven, let your fire fall down on me. Rekindle the fire within me, Lord, once again. All I want to do is love you. All I want to do is worship. All I want to do is lay here right at your feet. As I lift my hands toward heaven, let your fire fall down on me. Rekindle the fire within me, Lord, once again. Surround me. Your presence fill this place and surround me, oh Lord. Surround me, oh Lord. Surround me, oh Lord. Let your presence fill this
me, Lord, once again. All I want to do is love you. All I want to do is worship. All I want to do is lay here right at your feet. As I lift my hands toward heaven, let your fire fall down on me. Rekindle the fire within me, Lord. Hallelujah. Aren't you thankful for the power of the Holy Ghost? Aren't you thankful that we can live a life that's separated from this world? Amen. Hallelujah. Pastor Dustin, come and dismiss us in prayer tonight.
Lord Jesus, we thank you, God, for the word, God, that was given tonight. Lord, I pray it be instilled within our hearts, God. We were meant to be men and women to pursue you, God, and to live a holy and righteous life before our family. God, I pray that you would take this congregation of people, God, and my family as well, God, that you would keep us, form a hedge of protection around us, Lord, over our minds and over our hearts. God, keep us that when we come back Wednesday, that God will have testimonies of the things that, God, you have brought us from, set us free from, and God, how that you have kept us safe. In Jesus' name, amen.